Department of Islamic Art, and it is my privilege this afternoon to introduce these four speakers. Our first speaker is my former colleague and friend, Stefan Heidemann, professor of Islamic studies at Hamburg University, and formerly associate curator of Islamic art at this institution, and before that, professor of Islamic history and material culture at the Bard Graduate Center. He holds a master's and doctorate degree from the Freie Universität Berlin, and has had in his very rich career fellowships from Dumbarton Oaks, Hebrew University in Jerusalem, the Aga Khan program at MIT, and the Fitzwilliam Museum at Cambridge. His wide range of publications includes works on numismatics, urbanism, metalware, and iconography, in a whole series of published books and many, many articles. His subject today is the large audience, life-size stucco figures of royal princes, and would you please join me in welcoming Stefan Heidemann. Let me say one more thing. Sorry, I want you to applaud, but I'll tell all the speakers, we must be out of here irrevocably at 5 o'clock. So after you've been talking, Stefan, for about 23 and one quarter minutes, if you haven't stopped, you'll see a yellow shirt down here in the aisle, and that's a signal for you to wrap up. Okay, and please, again, welcome.
Thank you for this nice and kind introduction. And I also like to thank and congratulate the organizers for this inspiring conference and for inviting me. And it's a special honor for me to speak about our iconic pieces of this conference, a fly-in. So, both iconic figures, masterpieces of the museum's splendid collection, are also the largest and most embellished of their kind. They belong to a group of very similar figures. None of the known comparable stucco figures is reported from any controlled excavation. The iconographical and special context is lost. Both figures arrived through private collections and ultimately through the antiquity market of the early 20th century. When a building decays over time or collapses, stucco usually falls off the wall, smashes, and breaks into many pieces. The raised parts became damaged, especially the face and the hands, which is not the case in this, with these figures. The floor will be cluttered with fragments and stucco from inscriptions and miscellaneous parts of the decoration, such as arabesques, decorative fresco painting, parts of rosettes, and so on, and then covered with sand, dust, and debris for centuries. Dealers and their workers collect from the floor what they regarded as possible merchandise. Spherical massive heads are easily to be spotted within the rubble, and apparently sometimes also massive decorative torus of a figure. The detailed background, delicate epigraphic bands, and other embellishing details vanish as unspecific stucco fragments. They may be later reimagined in a reassembled composite stucco revetment for the market. That way, several heads and some figures, such as those at the Metz collection, but no complete panel survived. Heads and figures are only physical remains of presumably large polychrome revetments which once covered entire reception halls. After a brief introduction into the tradition of stucco figures from the ancient Orient to the Middle Islamic period, I will attempt to revise the dating based on the epigraphy and the armory. Then I proceed to ask the question whether these are palace guards or princely figures. And I conclude to ask about the architectural context and the function. The almost life-size royal figures stand in a tradition going back to the ancient Near East, but they are extraordinary for their very late time. We find frontal figures in Hatra of the 2nd, in Takibustan of the 7th century, and a life-size image of the caliph from Khirbet al-Mashra from the early 8th century. On the other hand, a lavish vegetal, polychrome stucco paneling and ceiling decoration embellished early palaces estates as integral part of the architectural decorative programs. From the Abbasid period on, we know almost only vegetal, geometric, incised or carved stucco panels from the palaces such as those in Arakka, in Samarra for start, and Nishapur in eastern Iran. The tradition of post-Samarran non-figural stucco was continued in Iran and in the Ghaznavid palaces at Lashkari Bazar and in the Kashan region until the middle of the 12th century. A time gap of several centuries lies between the last figural stuccos from the Umayyad palaces and the figures in the Metropolitan Museum. From Samarra and Nishapur, figural images, however, are at least known from polychrome frescoes, but we have no sculptural human figures. In Central Asia, royal imagery continued as polychrome wall frescoes almost uninterrupted from the pre-Islamic Sogdian period. Most prominent are those from the Ghaznavid palaces in Lashkari Bazar from the mid-11th century and from the Karakhani palaces in Afrasiab, Old Samarkand, from the 12th century. But we have also to look at other media. Here, just an impression from Samarkand. Artistically connected with the architectural decoration are polychrome paintings on minai ware of the late 12th and 13th century. Stucco figures from the Middle Islamic period. In the Seljuk period, figural imagery returned as a major theme in decorative arts. The two figures in the Metropolitan Museum are by far the largest and most embellished figures of their kind. They all were freely formed in plaster by hands. Details, embroideries, jewels, and the tiras bands were all carved into almost dry plaster. Then the figures were painted and partially gilded. Both figures are shown frontally in a dominant blue and red kaftan. They measure from the hemline of the coat to the top of the crown almost exactly measures 115 to 116 centimeters, affirming their supposed origin from the same decorative program or stucco revetment. The one with the jeweled crown is complete with boots and has an original height of 144 centimeters. Both figures have in common round, beardless moon faces, fashionable in Eastern and Western Iran, and generally associated with the Turks. The closest parallel in size and decoration is the figure in the Detroit Institute of Art. It is a little bit shorter, 101 centimeters from the boots to the crown, but it shows almost the same color scheme of blue with black contours and gilt details, but without red. Three smaller figures and two figural stucco elements form a group of fragments at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. And all three figures come presumably from the same revetment or at least from the same architectural program. One is seated, another one is standing with a winged crown, and the third one has a jeweled diadem. And one recent acquisition of the Sabah collection in Kuwait is heavily restored beyond any analytical recognition, especially in those parts which will be necessary for further analysis, such as the crown and the hands. A figure with a vivid gesture and motion in the Staatliche Museen in Berlin also belongs to the comparative group. The Berlin figure is unique because it captures a figure with long swinging hairs in a movement with his or her arm raised. In 1931, Riefstahl attempted a dating to the 12th and 13th century on the shaky ground of stylistic reasons of unprovenanced figures at a time when the study of Islamic art was still at its infancy. I propose a slightly earlier dating based on two details, the epigraphy and the armory. At an important hunch for the dating, is provided by the calligraphy of the tirage brassards. The cartouche on the upper sleeves show part of the inscription. Both figures share the same calligraphical details. Although the inscription of the figure with the wind crown is divided between the two cartouches on both sleeves, it may be interpreted, and I'm very grateful to Abdullah Gucciani for some advice, as part of a continuing Quranic phrase with the center, Alaikum bil Mu'minin. The letters of both Metz figures and the one in Detroit have triangular fins at the tops of the vertical parts of each letters and swan-shaped noons and wows. The high-rising shadows above every low vertical letter are upraised stumps of exaggerated pointed letter tops. They are helpful for the dating. Since the early 10th century, these pointed tops evolved, reaching for low vertical letters, even the same height as for long vertical letters. Here a long vertical letter, and here these tops, these fins, reaching the same height. This style was popular in the East during the 11th century until the middle decades of the 12th century. A tombstone in Rasna dated about the 1150s, and another one attributed to Yazd dated 1122, and a minbar, a panel in the Metropolitan Museum's collection made also in Yazd, dated Jumada 1546, which is in the year 1151. These are fine examples of this calligraphic feature. An assumed dating of the Metropolitan's and Detroit's figures falls on epigraphic reasons between the decades around the 1050s and the decades around the 1150s, but probably more towards the first half of the 12th century. A second datable feature is a saber. Both figures have their left hand rested on a hilt of a slightly curved large sword or saber. Sabers are known at least since the 6th to 8th century among the Turks outside the Islamic Empire, as seen on almost lifestyle stone stelae from the Eurasian steppes. However, the Abbasid armies did not use them. The saber seems to have entered the Islamic Empire first with the intrusion of the Rus tribes and following the Seljuk conquest. The earliest known dated appearance of a saber in Islamic art is on a Karahani coin falz from the year 415-1024, and within the Seljuk Empire itself on a gold dinar from Herat dated 1047. As a terminus postquem, it would correspond with the epigraphic style of the tirage band into the Seljuk period. Palace guards are princely figures. While the earliest Umayyad figures of caliphs are shown standing and facing, since the 9th century, royal or princely figures in the Islamic Empire are typically depicted in a cross-legged sitting position. Even in the 12th century and 13th century, they are still cross-legged and sitting. They wear mostly felt caps with a thick fur brim, a mitre-like sarpouche or a turban. Even on Minai ware, we find always the cross-legged sitting ruler. Frontally, standing figures with swords in a similar posture are known also from other visual and architectural contexts. For example, in northern Mesopotamia and Sinjar, Melanie Gibson, and I regret that she is not today with us, identified them in an article which is in print as royal guards. She included in her samples also our two figures of the Metropolitan Museum. Is it possible that the figures of the Metropolitan Museum are mere royal guards? I will argue as they are princes or royals. My arguments are based on crown types and a Turkic Central Asian tradition of standing royal figures, which is not considered by Melanie Gibson because they are outside the Islamic Empire from where the Seljuks come from. Both figure crowns, headgear, and hairstyle of the two Metropolitan Museum's figures are important features. Both figures were elaborate and partly gilded crowns, lavishly studded with jewels. One has a winged crown, and the other a jeweled triple-lobed diadem. The better preserved headgear of the latter consists of three parts. First, the felt cap. The felt cap is common also with figures on Minai wear. Secondly, a pleated veil covering the top of the cap of both of the Met's figures, and at least of two of the crowns of the VMA's figures. Such a golden veil is also shown as sign of rulership at the central figure on a Minai bowl of the late 12th and 13th century. And certainly the triple-lobed jeweled diadem. Two of the VMA's figures share such a headgear. The three panels are adorned with different ornamentation on each of these diadems. The form of the paneled crown seems to be more common in Central Asia than in the western part of the empire. They are also found with the contemporary Song dynasty. The second figure shares the same hairstyle, but with a different headgear. It carries a winged crown. The two wings are pointed toward opposite direction with a central teardrop-shaped palmetto in the middle. As the Met's one, Detroit's figures and the VMA wear such winged crowns. Winged crowns are known from the Sasanian period as a symbol of Ahura Mazda and had become an icon for Iranian royalty. Winged crown resurfaced again in the 10th century. The first known rendering are on presentation coins of the Buyid ruler Rukn ad-Dawla and Adud ad-Dawla in western Iran and Iraq. After the decline of the Abbasid Empire in the early 10th century, these images were meant to shed a favorable light on the new dynasties of Iranian and Turkish origin as revivers of the past glory of the Abbasids in Iraq, which the Abbasids had failed to provide. Sasanian crowns were adopted in silverware, presentation coins, and other media, even on polychrome Minai ware, and unexpectedly also on Syrian. The Syrian lusterware doesn't want to come. Yes, there it is. Also on Persian lusterware. The standing ruler. These elements make the two figures rulers in the Iranian tradition and not just palace guards. But still, the frontal standing position remains yet to be explained. Katharina Otto Dorn traces the invention of the Islamic cross-legged ruler back to the old Turkish stele. Especially she refers to the stele of Chul Asgard in Mongolia from the middle decades of the 8th century as the earliest depiction of such a seated fashion, which actually also is known from Kushan coins. The Eastern Turkish features are strong. One influence might have come from another class of Turkish stele from the 6th to the 10th century. They are standing and even having the left hand resting on a dagger, sword, or saber. These frontal-facing figures were used as funeral memorials of rulers and dignitaries, but they also may be part of other religious rituals. The Seljuks have their origin in these Eurasian steppes. The representational function of the old Turkish stele might have been translated into the representation of Turkish rulership in a palatial context in eastern Iran. But there's another explanation to which I will come now. The architectural context, the awkwardly bent, impossible hand position on the hilt of the winged crown figure, and the impossible form of the saber raises questions and might enlighten us, finally. The explanation seems to support the theory that the two figures are in fact a matching pair, and we might detect here some last changes in the composition which will give us clues about the decorative function of the figures. Frontal, stiff human figures are symmetrical almost by definition. What defines both figures is their mirror-shaped symmetrical relation as a pair. It's the position of the arms. Here I mirrored on the one with the jeweled diadem, and please pay attention to the position of the arms. One is the right arm is above the left arm, and the other way around. The diademed figure has his left arm below his right arm, and the winged crown figure shows just the opposite. The right arm is below its left. This would correspond to such a symmetrical pair on one of the walls in an axial hall, both in the view axis of the visitor. But the arm position is uncommon for such figures. Most commonly, however, and the conventional images is always that the left arm is positioned under the right arm. This convention can be even traced back to the abundant depiction of priestly attendants on Sasanian coins. The one group of the old Turkish stele rest also their left hand on the dagger, sword, or saber. The change in design for the figure with the wing crown must have occurred when it was almost ready and almost ready and for the fine detailing and modeling and the carving of the decoration. The position of the saber might be the clue. The saber of both figures is correctly positioned at their left side, while the left hand is resting on the hilt. Having the attire of the royal figures as realistic as possible, a symmetrical sword on the opposite, that means on the right side, would have been looked just wrong in a military society of warriors. The only way to correct the position of the sword at the last stage of modeling was to correct the position of the hand at the time when the stumps of the arms might have been already dried or fixed. This final change in composition from the mirror symmetry to realistic left side positioning of the saber might have been the cause for the unsatisfactory change in design. As a result, the left hand of the winged crown figure was adjusted to the rest somewhat awkwardly on the saber. This is not the only not only left the left hand unnaturally bent, but also the saber was impossibly rendered. It has its prominent jeweled protective guard immediately just below the roundel, leaving no space for the hilt itself. Another oddity in this region of the chest is hinting for last-minute changes. Without any obvious function are these bow tie joints or buttoned, four in the row, so there's one even up there, and on the other side as well. And yesterday I went again to the figures and saw even three of these buttons, which have no function in the chest piece of the figure and might be just remnants of an earlier design. This implies that a remodeling of the kaftan was done with another layer or plaster, possibly in the wake of the change of the hand position. Conclusion, the audience hall. The Metropolitan Museum stuccos were part of a decoration in a reception hall. They were probably originally designed in a mirror-like symmetry. The observer might have both in his view at the same time, meaning they were in the same stucco revetment. The crowns, especially the winged one, established them as royal representations. The closer parallels within architectural context offers frescoes in central Asian palaces, such as in Bust or in Afrasiab or Samarkand. The palace complex of ancient Bust is located in the Helmand province in present-day Afghanistan. The palace was built during the reign of Mahmud of Ghazna and extended by his son Mas'ud, who took residence there in 1036 or 1037. In about 1050s, during the Seljuk invasion, these palaces were pillaged and Bust was destroyed. A fresco mural shows 44 standing courtly figures, almost at the same size as the Metz figures. In the Bust reception hall, all figures have Turkic, Asiatic, beardless, moon face features and wear similar kaftans with blue and red and with brassard tiras. The murals are interpreted as royal audience. The Ghaznavid chronicler Bayhaqi describes such lavish receptions. If we see the Metz figure and the others of the group in the tradition of these murals, then their polychromy fetches obviously more importance by the artist than their figural aspect. They might be seen as just a three-dimensional form of a mural painting which has a long tradition in Central Asian art. These stuccos should be looked at less as figures, as we have it now presented in the galleries, but more as a kind of three-dimensional substrates for decorative polychrome coverings, a topic which will be addressed in detail by my colleague Jean-François de Lapérouse soon. Polychrome stucco figures provide the hall with a greater depth than just a mural. The figures on the hall would increase the audience within the room, just almost fulfilling the same function, as the mirrors in the Great Hall of Mirrors in Versailles. In a hall already filled with ostentatiously dressed dignitaries, these red, blue, and gold-colored royal figures enhances the splendors and the largesse of the rulers' receptions. But there's one difference. All attendant figures in Lashkari Bazaar are shown in a three-quarter perspective, and all the attendants in all on all the minai were. Looking at a central figure, which is missing in Bust, but we have them on minai were. And the central figures is imagined as facing to the audience. Here an example from such an audience scene on Minaiware. Minaiware of the 12th and early 13th century always shows only one ruler facing and sitting cross-legged. The attendants are standing, sometimes bowing, but always standing in a three-quarter perspective. But curiously, no stucco three-quarter figures of such a revetment seems to have survived, only frontal figures, with the exception of the Berlin one, which is not one of the usual attendants, as we have it in the murals of Bust. But two royal figures on one side of the hall, how should this be interpreted? They were probably not center figures, but more, this is a suggestion, one princely figure in an artificially more than one princely figure in an artificially enlarged audience might have enhanced the claim of a Seljuk sultan as being Shahanshah, king of kings. And if we take both as royal representations, they may be attendants as kings for an audience of a Shahanshah. Thank you so much for your attention. Yeah.
Many thanks, Stefan, for that excellent presentation, which adhered rigorously to the previously set time limit, best of all. You've noticed in other sessions of the symposium that the symposium has skillfully incorporated not only the works of art historians, but the works of the Metropolitan's amazing team of conservators, such as the case also with this, the last session of the symposium. Jean-François de Lapérouse is a graduate of Princeton University and the Institute of Fine Arts of New York University, across the street, where he completed the conservation program. Since coming to our museum, he has also completed all of the coursework required for a doctoral degree in ancient Near Eastern art and archaeology at the IFA. His conservation work is focused primarily on the ancient Near East and Islamic collections. Today, his talk is entitled Parsing the Painted Surface, an Examination of the Polychromy on Two 11th, 12th Century Persian Stucco Figures. Please welcome Jean-François de Lapérouse.
I will try to also be on time, although I do have a stutter that sometimes trips me up. But when these two pieces came down as part of the re-examination of the collection, I've always loved these pieces, and just having them there in the lab to study up close was a wonderful opportunity. And I suggested to Stefan that maybe he could join with my colleague Vicky Perry and me to look at these pieces. And we also received the support of Mark Wapiski and Adriana Rizzo in the scientific research department. And I think this is just a great example. Unfortunately, Stefan is no longer with us, but I think it's a great example of the best results from studies come from when the curatorial and conservation staffs work together, and I hope that these kind of projects will continue in the future. Now, I know there might be a groan after all the beautiful all the beautiful sides we've seen of art objects to suddenly see this slide, but I was emboldened by the subject of the conference and also the keynote remarks by Renato Hallod about the history of seeing, just to make us think that, you know, since the 20th and now the 21st centuries, the way in which we see objects has broadened across the electromagnetic spectrum from just the narrow band that we call visible light to, on the one end, infrared, and then on the other end, ultraviolet and X-rays. And X-rays are used in many of the instrumental analysis techniques we use today. And all of this was brought to bear as we examined each object that that was brought down before it went on view. And I just thought I'd start as an introduction just to show as an example of these two Seljuk period ewers, the one on the left, obviously metal, and the one on the right in ceramic, which shows the wonderful influence of metal types on clay objects, but how they kind of gets expanded and with this wonderful coloristic effects that you could only do in ceramic. And when we looked at the metal piece under UV light, though, we did see, and you see these brighter areas at the base of the neck, at the base of the handle, and then these two or three areas in the neck. Those are small fills. But the ones at the base of the handle and the base of the neck kind of raise red flags, because obviously these are adhesive joins. Adhesives and paints will fluoresce in UV light. So this caused us to reconsider whether or not these two parts actually belong together. And in speaking with the curators, we were made to understand that from the literature, it's known that the body and the neck and handle would have been cast separately. So although we can't say for sure, since this is a modern join, that they belong together, we do, you know, give the piece the benefit of the doubt. With the ceramic piece, it's unfortunately not the case. I think you can see in the radiograph on the left, there's kind of a dark ring around the base of the neck, and also a smaller one around the base of the handle. And what it appears in this case is that there were two authentically old pieces that probably had a rough break edge where there was a break in the patch, and they were either cut or filed down and glued back together, and the join was very well done. But I think also when you understand this and you re-examine the piece, on the right you can see how differently the luster decoration was handled. It was definitely a different hand in both cases. Getting more closer to the issue with the two stucco figures, perhaps, is this Ilkhanid pilgrim flask that actually, this was a few years ago when Stefano Carboni was still here. He was going to publish this piece and asked us to look at it. And under the microscope, you could see that what should be red and white enamel, as you would find in a Lajvardina piece, was actually going down into the join lines. This piece had been broken and reassembled in the past. And it turned out that it was not actually baked on enamel, but it was a paint that was soluble in organic solvents. And Mark kindly did an analysis for us and found lithopone, a barium sulfate zinc oxide ingredient that's only found in modern paints, at least since the beginning of the last century. So if you go up and see this piece in the galleries now, the decision at that time was to take the paint and the gilding off one side, and that's the side that is on view upstairs. And so now coming back to our stars here, you know, when we were looking at all the pieces in the galleries, I think it was, you know, it behooved us in the conservation department to kind of play devil's advocate with each piece and just try to ascertain if there was anything that would be inconsistent with the proposed provenance of the piece. I guess I'm getting a little, oh there, I'm sorry. Well, we did radiographs, nothing much showed up there, but as Stefan pointed out to you, there are these breaks. This is the figure with the winged headdress, and someone put these massive pins through the break line there, and then you see the hanging straps, but nothing much was all that much visible in the radiographs. I was hoping that there would be a base of lime plaster because there is. I spoke a number of years ago with a scientist specializing in carbon-14 dating, and there is a possibility, at least theoretically, that you could be able to date the carbon that is the carbon from the carbon dioxide that is taken up as slake lime sets. But of course, these pieces are gypsum plaster, and there is really no way to date that. Looking at this is again the bottom of the figure with the winged headdress. You can see on the up close on the bottom of the right, all these voids. There are different levels here, and on the right, the image at the top is from the surface layer. It's a very fine gypsum, which would have made sense because the surface layer is where they would have wanted to burnish the surface in preparation for the painting, and also did a lot of carving while the plaster was set, but I'm sure it was still wet. And underneath that image is showing this more coarse plaster that contains essentially sand. I mean, they're quartz particles, oxide mineral particles, and they might have helped as they were building up the figure, perhaps in situ, to hold the plaster together if they were working vertically. These are just images to show around both faces, and I'm sorry, the 19 is an artifact there that was left over, but around both faces, and you see the winged crown figure on the left and the jeweled crown figure on the right, that there's voids and lines around the faces. It's just interesting just to, you know, to kind of reconstruct how the artist approached this. I guess doing the face was probably a quite important part, and they did other areas first and then left that for later on. And also above these tiras sections on the sleeves, they're these kind of triangular areas that look as if they're cut in through the decoration at a later point. So again, going along with the idea of subsequent changes, which Stefan was mentioning, you can look at these pieces and reconstruct what it was like do the different parts. Now, since we don't have a way to date this piece, we're looking at the surface of the piece based on one's experience or sense of what an archaeological surface should look like, I have to say that the surface on this piece does look rather convincing. You do have these areas of polychromy that underlie dirt in some places. In other areas, it's been rather heavily cleaned, and they have kind of shaved off areas, which is a bit unfortunate. But there's nothing in the surface condition that kind of caused me any concern. It's interesting, on the right here, you see a detail of the hand of the figure with the winged headdress, and it's one of the few areas on the surface where you can still kind of get a sense of the burnishing marks on the thumb and the hand there. But much of the surface, as you see on the right, is very scraped otherwise heavily abraded. This detail, and I'm not sure if it actually shows very well, but there's kind of a little line here, and I think a little line up here, and you can see that there are these very, very faint scribed lines where the artist would have laid out these kind of vegetal ornaments that are between the bands, and it's kind of interesting. We also saw similar scribe lines in the wall paintings from Nishapur that are on view upstairs. And this is an area, again, as Stefan was mentioning, there was a lot of changes in this area. And what's interesting is that the decoration, these vegetal ornaments that are between the red lines there, were actually painted on and then cut through in this subsequent change. So it happened at a fairly late period, one would think, of the creation of the space. And this is a detail under the proper left elbow of the finger of the figure with the winged headdress. I was, interested in this area here. At first, when I saw it, it looks like a kind of a blossom with radiating petals around it. I thought it was maybe supporting the idea that these were part of a larger landscape scene. In speaking with Stefan, it might be part of where part of the sleeve was hanging down. We're not quite sure, although you don't see the same detail on the other side. But it's one of these minor details that I think is indicative that this piece was probably not, this piece would have has evidence left that indicates that it was an authentic piece that was taken out of a larger background. Now, there is a lot of very, very faint polychromy. And here you can see these bands. You see the thin blue bands. I wonder if it's piping or if it's stripes on the kaftan of the figure with the jeweled headdress. And then you see these cross marks on the surface underneath against a red field. Again, looking at this picture again, this is these kind of vegetal shapes that appear between the red bands on the other figure. And then trying to bring out the dark lines, we had the assistance of Greg Bailey, a CREST fellow this year in our department, to take some IR reflectography images. IR, black pigments will absorb IR, which is essentially heat, and you can therefore, it's sometimes used with paintings to bring out an underdrawing. And we tried here to see if we could heighten the remnants of the black paint that was there. I think it didn't do terribly much, but I think it did kind of push back the noise that is the bright colors in the photographs you see here. And then this is the area of the lower section of the figure with the winged headdress. There was on the undergarment a design that was very, very hard to make out in person. And so this is, again, an IR, infrared reflectography photograph. And I don't really know if you can see it, but I spent a long time looking at this, trying to trace the design, because at first it looked like there were squares with small crosses inside. But actually, I finally realized that there were these cruciform shapes that then created these rectangular fields in which then there were also squares, also crosses. And at the bottom, you can see there are these blossoms in the lower hem area with these blue fields. I started to draw, but there's so little there that it was impossible to reliably reconstruct what is there. But this is an example of one of those spaces. So the palette on both figures was rather limited. You just had blue, this orange red. Let's see. And you see the orange red is in different hues, and I'll come back to that later on. And then this kind of a cherry red that is mostly on the figure with the jeweled crown, but also you find it in areas on the other figure as well. And here, this is actually where you find it mostly on the figure with the winged headdress. And black. Black was used, as I think you've already seen, for the outlines of the designs, the crosses, but also large fields of black to denote the hair and the facial features. Well, you know, in conservation, we work a lot with delayed gratification. And I really wanted to see what these would have looked like. So even before exactly knowing what all the pigments were, I tried to do a reconstruction. And I had to choose an area where I felt that I didn't have to invent very much. And I know the result, it kind of looks like a chromolithograph. It's a little bit too bold and perhaps too regular, because I think these crosses were done, you can see, in a very kind of quick and kind of a very easy stroke. And when you're trying to copy something, it gets more regularized. But at least it gives one an idea. One thing I didn't mention there, and I should go back, is about the gilding. And I'm afraid it's really hard to get an excellent photograph of the gilt areas, but you see some right here. There's some right here as well, and I think some in that area there. And Mark took samples from both pieces, and they both consist of gold with about 14% silver and a small amount of copper. There seems to be, neither under the gold nor any of the other colors, does there seem to be any ground. It just seems to have been applied directly to the surface as a kind of a wash. There might be a very, very slight white ground, though, under some of the blues, but they're also mixed with lead white, and I'm not quite sure if the scraping has made it appear more white there than it actually is. And this is then a reconstruction of the lower section of the other piece. So looking at the pigment samples, this is a sample of synthetic ultramarine, and this is at about 500 times magnification. And you can see that with synthetic ultramarine, you get very, very fine particles, because in order for the reaction to take place, you really need to grind the powder down. And then under cross polarized light, you really don't see much. They're just these opaque particles. And this is a picture on the left of the Berlin figure. And I know that Uta Franca has studied this piece at the museum, and it is her opinion that the blue on the figure is artificial ultramarine. And I have two examples from our lab of two different blue ultramarines. It's interesting how, I guess, the color varies considerably depending on the manufacturer. But this is a sample taken from the lower hem area, where there have those little rosettes of the figure with the winged headdress. And here I think you can see that you have these angular bits of minerals that have conchoidal fracture. They're slightly transparent. And here is a close-up, again, of more of those with the photo on the right of a actual piece of lapis lazuli, which is quite wonderful. It has specks of pyrite going down the center, and then a bit of limestone on the back of the piece. And that's one characteristic of natural ultramarine, is that you will have these impurities of limestone. And under cross polars, which here you see on the right, they are anisotropic, and you will see kind of this optical activity. And this is a sample from the figure with the jeweled crown. So that also does have ultramarine on it, natural ultramarine. Now that doesn't prove that the paint is right, but at least it doesn't disprove that the paint could be right. The other issue is, of course, and you know, this work is still ongoing. I don't know if all the blue on both figures is absolutely correct, but I think this is at least a hopeful indication. Now, the red-orange from both figures, we found red lead by EDS analysis on both figures, and this sample on the left is from the figure with the winged headdress, and on the right, this is a standard sample of red lead. Now, red lead, of course, is a synthetic paint by itself, but it had a long history before this time, there's no reason why it could not have been found on the sculptures given their date. We did not find, though, any other red, no cinnabar, perhaps a bit of red lead mark detected in one of the samples. And this is a sample of modern red lead with a square of it there. Perhaps I should have painted my reconstruction with red lead, but I don't think it's a very healthy pigment to be playing around with. Well, one thing that concerned me was the color of the orange, because if you go and look at the pieces upstairs, it's really bright. And I think that's one thing that people have always thought when they look at that, they can't imagine that orange could be right. But as you can see, it really is the color of red lead. But when I started looking close with Vicky, one thing we felt is that the orange is kind of smeared around a bit, and that when you look at the edges of those areas, it's very dark. And it was very hard, even under magnification, to see what's actually going on. I mean, are these smudges over something darker, or is it a kind of a daub of something over a darkened paint? But it got me to thinking about the issue of the discoloration of red lead. And it's a well-known problem where red lead, and but all the, it's a well-known problem, but actually the mechanism by which it occurs is still under study, because I think it's quite complex and it might involve several different factors, as I indicate here. But red lead will change oxidation state to platinurite, which is a dark mineral. And I would call your attention here to this area here on this part of this sample, where it's not actually black yet, but it's kind of brown because there's a very thin layer of the platinurite that is formed on top of the red lead. This has been studied recently at the caves in the Duhuang region of China, where the red lead was added to white to produce a flesh tone, and has since discolored to this dark brown. So what I'm wondering here, and again, this is a very small area right here between both sleeves, in this line here, where you see this very dark brown over here, and then this kind of more orangish area over here. And what I'm wondering is, during the cleaning, if they didn't somehow scrape through that top brown layer to reveal this bright orange. And I believe that these kind of small hatch lines are kind of probably when someone was using a scalpel when the piece was cleaned in the past. So they probably were using small knives and scalpels to remove as much as they could of the incrustation. Now the red, the bright cherry red, though, is not such a favorable result. This is a mixture of red lead, but contains a pigment known as PR57 that was first produced in 1902. And here I show a close-up. There was also a lot of barium sulfite that was found in this pigment that might have been used as kind of a base for the that became stained with this red dye. And here I show an example, and it really is quite close in color to the red that you see here that is on both pieces. And also, I think when you look more closely at how this red is applied, it's kind of applied around where the incrustation was left. So I do think that in these areas, this red was added. Hopefully, though, it was probably, they were probably trying to heighten very faint vestiges they saw when they first recovered the pieces. So what are we left with? Well, I do think that much of the polychromy on both pieces is original, or at least there's enough there for us to know what they would have looked like. And I do think that, though, that the figure with the jeweled crown, though, might have had a little bit less color on it and has been heightened more than the figure with the winged headdress. But frankly, his design of the caftan is a little more interesting, and I guess it's appropriate that the winged headdress one is on the front of the pamphlet for our conference here. And then just to get back to the point that Stefan made, I was very pleased that the polychromy in this case is the most important part. But all joking aside, I do think these were meant to be very vibrant, very forceful images, which is somewhat hard to tell when you look at them now. And I would just like to thank everyone, and especially the collection manager and the three technicians who let me get into the case every Monday possible, so I could continue to take samples. Thank you very much.
Unfortunately, Dr. Melanie Gibson has been unable to attend the conference today, but her paper will be read by my colleague, Dr. Denise Beazet. I will, however, give you a little idea about Melanie Gibson. She's been director and tutor of the Islamic module of the Postgraduate Diploma in Asian Art at the School of Oriental and African Studies, SOAS, at London University since 2006. And her doctoral thesis was indeed on glazed ceramic sculpture from Iran and Syria during precisely the period that we're talking about today. She has produced work for two catalogs of the Khalili collection in London and has also recently authored an important study of Seljuk stucco sculpture. And Denise will now read Dr. Melanie Gibson's paper, which is entitled Mother and Child, A Group of Ceramic Figurines from Iran and Syria. And you can applaud her anyway for pinch hitting at the last minute.
Well, just an anecdote. When Sheila asked me if I could read this paper, I thought, oh, but I won't be able to ask questions because I don't know the topic. But as a new mom of a 3 months old little daughter who I nurse and who refuses constantly the bottle, I think I know quite a lot about the topic. Maybe not about the sculptures, but about the topic of mother and the child. So, mother and child, a group of ceramic figurines from Iran and Syria. I'm so very sorry not to be delivering this paper myself today and not to have been able to attend this interesting conference where so many of my friends are gathered and also so many scholars I was very much hoping to meet. My thanks to the kind person who is reading this for me. You're welcome. I would welcome any comments or queries on this subject. Do please contact me at the email address on the screen. Is this the pointer? So, yeah. The subject of my doctorate thesis was a group of glazed ceramic figurines that were produced in Kashan and in Raqqa in the peak period of luxury ceramics production from the mid-12th to mid-13th centuries. When I started my research, I found that scholarly opinion tended to identify any three-dimensional ceramic depictions as rare and unusual. But by the time I was finished, I had assembled a database with hundreds of examples, at least count some 339. That's a lot. And new examples keep emerging. As is so often the case with medieval Islamic ceramics, the objects themselves remain the primary source of information. To date, no example has been found in an archaeological context that indicated any kind of secure dating, and specific textual references are few and far between. Oops. The 13 examples in the collection in the Metropolitan Museum are an excellent example of this situation. 9 of the 13 objects were acquired from New York dealers and donated to the museum in the period from 1964 to 1969, a time when Ernst Grube was acting as curator. The donations reflect this particular interest in this area. He published the first article on ceramic figures in 1966, the two bovine figures in the upper left corner, originally glazed turquoise, but not now very iridized, were catalogued as coming from Raqqa when they reached the museum in 1930. The figures fall into specific subject groups with human figures shown drinking, playing musical instruments, riding on a horseback, or suckling a child from a naked breast, the group on which I will be focusing this afternoon. The largest group represent animals, elephants, camels, monkeys, crouching lions, and most numerous of all, a very schematic quadruped recognizable as a bull or cow. There are also different birds, ranging from raptors to songbirds, as well as mythical animals, such as the harpy and the sphinx. In visual and technical terms, there is no doubt the figurines all belong to the same group, but the paucity of archaeological and documentary evidence to help place the objects in their social and cultural context means that any assessments of their date and provenance are largely dependent on comparative material. From a technical aspect, they conform to the decorative styles developed in Kashan in central Iran and Raqqa in Syria during the period from mid-12th century to the Mongol invasions. Thus, we have simple monochrome glazed examples, the so-called Lakabi technique, associated with Syrian production, underglaze and luster painted examples. The figures could be made as functional objects, generally in the form of vessels, with openings or spouts from which liquid could be poured, but also as statuettes with a poorly decorative value. But practical use was never their prime function. You only have to look at the small scale of any handles, which look very awkward. The trigger for this new fashion for ceramic sculpture may have emerged from a synthesis of the new emphasis on figurative imagery combined with technological advances in the ceramics industry. Much as the invention of hard paste porcelain, here on the right side, encouraged Meissen factory artists to begin making figurines in the early 18th century. The catalyst in the Islamic world was the development of stone paste, a composite fabric with a high proportion of silica. It is not clear precisely when this development took place, but recent archaeological work in the Jami Mosque of Isfahan, in a section built by Nizam al-Mulk with a terminus date of 1087, has uncovered a cage of ceramic fragments of which 38% were stone paste, indicating that this change was well underway by the second half of the 11th century. Why should this change of body material have led to the production of three-dimensional objects? The answer lies in its relative inflexibility. The small amount of clay in the stone paste fabric made it less malleable than earthenware and consequently less easy to manipulate on the wheel. This restriction encouraged potters working with the siliceous material to refine molding and casting techniques and the manufacture of three-dimensional figure. No, sorry, I dropped a line. This restriction encouraged potters working with the siliceous material to refine molding and casting techniques, and the manufacture of three-dimensional objects was an obvious progression to such experiments. To create a three-dimensional figure, a positive matrix, here on the left, was carved in wood or shaped from clay. A mold was created from this. This single example of a mold has survived, found in an area in Tahti Suleiman that was identified as a ceramics workshop by Rudolf Naumann. Its appearance is something of an anomaly, as there is little evidence of the production of plastic figures in the Mongol period, or at least surviving ceramic figures are not decorated in styles currently associated with the Mongol period. So the crouching line on the right shows you the type of object made in such a mold. Its underglazed decoration places it firmly within what we think to be a pre-Mongol underglaze painted style. To date, 17 examples of women suckling a baby At the breast survive, the figurines are vile in quality as well as their decorative finishes. The finest example in the Islamic Museum in Berlin is large and superbly decorated, whereas other examples are smaller and were shaped and glazed in a more cursory manner. Whatever their overall quality, they all share certain characteristics. The figurines were formed in molds, which dictated a consistency in their shape, but details of costume and jewelry varied according to the potter's imagination. The best example in terms of potting and glazing is a large figure in Berlin. The figure has an opening at the top, so that's here, which suggests that the object was used as some kind of container, and the point of the headdress acted as a pouring lip. The molding is detailed, but only for those parts of the body that are exposed, the infant, the left breast, and the arms of the figure stand out in relief, but the infant's legs are cut off at the knee where they are hidden by the woman's hair. Oh, that's here. Also in relief are the pearl element of the woman's headdress and her facial features. The cross-legged figure cradles the child, definitely a toddler rather than a newborn, with both arms supporting its horizontal body. The child is naked and raises its hand to guide the breast into his open mouth, a very realistic gesture. The costume of the woman is clearly drawn. She wears an open coat with narrow sleeves fastened by a circular buckle below her hands over a wide shift, the chemise, through which her breast protrudes. The garment has tiara's bands on both sleeves, decorated with a looping ornament. The fabric of the coat is scattered with joined up crescents and confronted leaf shapes, and the folds of the cloth are indicated. Her hair hangs down almost to her knees in long tresses, more hang down along her shoulders, and a veil attached to the headdress hangs down her back. She wears a crown-shaped headdress. This appears to be an example of the isaba, a headdress described by Dozy in his Dictionary of Clothing as a piece. I'm sorry. As a piece. So this headdress is described by Dozy as a piece of richly embroidered fabric or lace studded with ornaments and tied around the head. The brow section of the head has been repainted and was probably marked with a tattoo in the center of the forehead. You can see she has a circular or moon-shaped face, which accords with contemporary notions of female beauty, as well as a dimpled chin, a thin mouth, and a series of tattoos on the sides of her cheeks, as well as on the center of each cheek. These two fragmentary heads are on the same scale as the Berlin example, and may well have been once attached to similar bodies. On both examples, you can see clearly the tattoo pattern in the center of the forehead that is missing from the Berlin figure, and you can here see clearly the projecting central section to the headdress, which would have guided the flow of the liquid when used as a pouring vessel. This lady is in the collection here at the Metropolitan Museum. When I first examined her, she had a differently shaped head. It was known from tests that some repainting on the face and headdress had occurred, and after recent conservation, the head has been remade with molded features that are physiologically correct, but perhaps a little more prominent than they would have been in the original, The original headdress may well have had a central peak rather than a flat profile, as in the other examples I have shown you. The molding of the details is not very crisp, but the arms and elbows of the figure and the infant are very visible in relief. The woman wears a garment with no apparent openings. The fabric is patterned with a busy folate scroll. There are no terrace bands on the sleeves. The wide cuffs are lined in a contrasting spotted fabric. At the back, you can see the band trying the tiara and the triangular veil terminating in a weighted knot to keep it smooth. The breasts are placed unnaturally high. The right breast is colored in luster, and the left breast is elongated and held in the child's hand. This figure, like the one in Berlin, is decorated with luster, and the use of this technique has an important bearing on the analysis of the date and provenance of the piece. A large number of the figurines are decorated with luster glazing styles developed in Kashan in the 12th century. Analysis first done by Oliver Watson and subsequently refined by Robert Mason isolated certain design elements and set them within a chronological framework. The figure's coat is decorated with two elements identified by Masson as belonging to the earliest phase of production. Unfortunately, it has so far been impossible to establish a precise date for the start of luster production in Kashan. The well-known piece in the British Museum bears the date 1179, and by this date, production was in full swing. I estimate that the start period was probably around 1150. The first decades of production would have been a time of experimentation and innovation in the pottery workshops, while the first generation of potters were perfecting the new body material and glazes, and it is to this phase that many of the figurines belong. A second figure in the Met is similar to the previous example in form and structure, but is decorated with underglaze painting under a transparent turquoise glaze. The oval-shaped breasts molded high on the body are heavily outlined and cross-hatched, again making them a prominent feature. The woman wears a garment patterned with a sketchily drawn foliate pattern with wide hanging sleeves. Rather than a necklace, the robe has a keyhole neckline. A series of dots around the neck may indicate a necklace or a band of fabric attached to the headdress. Her hair falls in long tresses over the shoulders to the waist and appears under the edge of the headdress. This has foliate decoration around the band and is held together with a ribbon tied at the back of the head. So that's, yeah, you can see it here. It sits over a triangular veil patterned with spots and hangs in a point secured with an ornament. Loose strands of her hair hang outside of the wheel. Her face is circular, with a dimpled chin, narrow almond-shaped extended eyes, thick arching eyebrows joined at the center, a small pursed mouth. The eyes, eyebrows, nose, and mouth of the infant are clearly drawn, and there seem to be tattoos on the cheek. It is swaddled in a cloth which covers her head and body. In general, it has been the opinion by scholars such as Ernst Grube, who did the earliest research on this group of objects for an article published in 1966, that the group of breastfeeding woman figures, as well as the majority of figurines, were made in Persian workshops. This was largely because many of the best-known examples were decorated in the easily recognizable Kashani luster style. So a figure such as this one, its theme and form so similar to others, with an undisputed Kashan provenance, was considered to have been Persian with little further questioning. In the wider context of the ceramics of this period, this assumption of Persian preeminence, an attitude that first emerged in the late 19th century and persisted throughout a series of important exhibitions from the 1930s to the 1970s, has rarely been re-examined. We know that the underglaze technique was in use in Kashani workshops by the early 13th century, evidence for this being the Macy jug, a virtuous piece of ceramics with reticulated walls with an inscription giving a date of 1215-1216. Other typical underglaze pieces are painted in a distinctive style with vigorous fluid brush strokes. These are generally dated to the early decades of the 13th century. But this same technique was very much in use in the workshops of Raqqa in Syria, as exemplified by these examples, which include both vesters and surface finds. I started to re-examine the provenance of the matte turquoise and black underglazed figure after I studied a very fragmentary example in the Freer collection in Washington. Charles Long Freer, who built up a large collection of Syrian ceramics in the period from 1908 to 1911, bought the majority of his pieces from an antiquities firm based in Aleppo, Vincenzo Marco Poli and Co. In a note written by the collector, he describes how a group of seven fragmentary objects, all eventually purchased by him, were found in Raqqa and taken directly to Marco Poli. The objects included six figurines, of which four are shown in this photograph on the right, that Marco Poli sent to Freer with a bull, two luster glazed female figures with hands held together, a large female figure with arms raised, it's not shown on this photograph, and a fragmentary head from a similar piece and the breastfeeding woman shown on the right. So the photograph is here and this is the breastfeeding woman. Four of the figures are unquestionably of Syrian manufacture by virtue of their form and decoration. Although the breastfeeding woman and the bull both belong to types associated with Persian manufacture and could have been imported from Kashan, it seems possible, given their discovery in Raqqa, that they could also have been of local manufacture. The surface of the Freer figure is so damaged by burial that the type of glazing is impossible to reconstruct. However, it is very close in form and dimensions to the Metropolitan underglaze painted figure and may well have had a similar underglaze decoration. One further point, perhaps the most convincing, towards the Syrian provenance for the Metropolitan breastfeeding figure is the rather distinctive style of painted decoration. The cloth of the woman's garment is decorated with loose foliate scrolls, random dashes, and curved lines, the very same quickly drawn motifs that are so frequently found on Raqqa pieces. This example, a surface find from Raqqa, now in the Aleppo Museum, makes the case convincingly. Two more comparable pieces have appeared at auction in the last few years, slightly larger than the Metropolitan example. They differ in several details. The woman holds the child in the opposite arm, a slightly mystifying change, as in the majority of depictions of suckling across the ages, the child was held in the mother's left arm, feeding from the breast nearest to the heart. A second difference is in the headdress, which, as you can see, falls in two long plaits braided with ribbon down the back, and on the front is attached below the chin with a spotted band of fabric or chain on the Doha example. So that's on the left side. And a double length of chain on the example sold at Bonhams. So this is here on the right side. This headdress was known as a buchnuk, a veil that was wrapped around the head and neck and was secured below the chin with a chain made of pearls or metal links. This relates to female headdresses shown in several illustrated manuscripts, such as two early 13th century Makamat manuscripts known to have been produced in Syria and the Jazeera. The large projecting elements at the sides of the head which appear to be covering the ears may be the potter's attempt to show the projecting element of the headdress shown in the 1222 Makamat image. Just a word on the tattoos, which are clearly visible in this blown up detail, and in fact are shown on all the female figures. They are small, mostly floral designs, applied to the forehead, cheeks, and chin. Several appear to have a word, unfortunately illegible, written on each cheek. Sir Percy Sikes, who noted that tattooing was universal amongst women in Iran until circa 1850, listed their purpose to embellish their charms, to avert the evil eye, to hide a scare or blemish, and to cure a malady. A word about the function and meaning of the breastfeeding figurines. It is impossible to assess from the figures if the woman portrayed should be understood as a mother or a wet nurse. The act of breastfeeding is mentioned in several Quranic verses in relation to the custom of wet nursing, which was widely practiced across the Islamic world. Muhammad was himself given to a wet nurse called Halima bint Abu Dhaib, who looked after him until he was 2 years old. The only illustration of a wet nurse that I have found occurs in a copy of the Jami al-Tawarikh, datable around 1430. Ghazan Khan is shown as a baby. Swaddled in a green cloth and wearing a white cap, being suckled by the wet nurse while his mother rests alongside her on an elaborate couch with bolsters. Both women wear the tall Mongol headdress and crossover gowns, although the inferior social status of the wet nurse is possibly indicated by her heavier features and simpler headdress with no feather. The existence of the figurines suggests that the theme of breastfeeding a child had a particular resonance in this period, but this is not borne out in contemporary iconography, where only one other object represents precisely the same subject. A tile, decorated in the Minae technique, depicts a woman who sits within a wooden framework like a cradle and suckles a child who appears to rest on a ledge within the frame. The infant, which has a curiously square head, is naked and holds its hand up to her breast to guide it into its mouth in a pose reminiscent of the sculptures. The key to the significance of this theme probably lies in the real and symbolic importance of breast milk. perceived in several cultures not only as a source of nourishment, but often with an added miraculous dimension. In Roman mythology, for instance, the Milky Way was supposedly created by Juno when her breast sprayed milk across the heavens while she was suckling Heracles. And in Turkish mythology, Yaik, one of the sons of the creator, was charged with bringing each fetus a drop of milk from the milk lake in heaven and thus imbuing it with humanity. Across the Islamic world, there are several textual references to the medical benefits of breast milk and its efficacy as treatment for a number of ailments, particularly blindness. In a Nawruzia poem by the 12th century poet Hakani, who died in 595-1199, the spring rains are compared to milk sprinkled from the nipples of the clouds, which would cure the ophthalmia affecting the eye of the garden. A passage from a Persian Ajaib al-Mahlukat cosmography dedicated to the last Seljuk ruler Turil III contained the lines, "In the region of Lur, there is a place where the sun shines for only 3 months a year and the remaining 9 months are dark. They have made an idol there in the form of a woman with two large breasts. They bring the sick there and they put their hands on her breasts. A drop of milk trickles and the sick person drinks it. The sickness goes away, but if nothing trickles, then he dies. Then the sick person makes a will from there, and this is a wondrous thing." Finally, in the book of Dede Korkut, the compilation of legends associated with the Oğuz Turks, the miraculous intervention of Khidr announces to the hero that he will be healed with a salve made of herbs combined with his mother's breast milk. In the Western medieval world, the popularity of the image of the Holy Mother suckling her son Jesus was rooted in this widespread belief that breast milk, and specifically Mary's milk, had miraculous properties. A legend widely disseminated in this period recounted that the Holy Family took refuge in a cave during the massacre of the innocents. Mary began to suckle Jesus while they hid, but when they departed in haste, some of her milk splashed on the rock of the cave, turning its color from red to white. Accounts of the miraculous qualities of this substance began circulating in the Holy Land and thence to Western Europe, and samples of pulverized white limestone were scrapped from the walls of this cave and sold as relics to pilgrims and crusaders. In the wake of the Fourth Crusade in 1204, Abbot Martin of Pyris returned to his abbey in Alsace, Laden, with hundreds of relics which had been removed from monasteries in Constantinople, and these included several containers of Mary's milk. There are numerous accounts of women visiting the site in the belief that the powder would help mothers having difficulty in producing breast milk. The most powerful Marian icon in the Crusader period was to be found at the monastery of Saitnaya, close to Damascus. Yeah. From the late 12th century, there are several accounts of a miraculous icon portraying Mary suckling Jesus that exuded oil, milk in some accounts, from her breasts, painted on its wooden surface. This icon no longer survives, but this 12th century example gives you some idea of what it might have looked like. Yeah, it's almost finished. I'm sorry, I didn't write the paper. The breasts of the original may have been shown in light relief with the addition of plaster, much you see here. An account by Burchard of Strasbourg, the ambassador of Frederick Barbarossa to the court of Saladin, who visited the convent in 1175, describes how Christian and Muslim pilgrims gathered on the feast of the Virgin to witness the miracle of this healing oil. A second account of the same period by a Coptic priest named Abu al-Makarim describes how 4,000 and 5,000 pilgrims would gather, a gathering of Muslims, Frankish Christians, as well as indigenous Nestorians and Melkites, and each of the pilgrims would be given a phial of the holy oil to take away. The veneration of the Virgin Mary taking place at Sadnaya was not limited to the Christian community. She represented an ideal of motherhood that appealed to women of all faith. It is still an active place of pilgrimage today, and So I think it's almost the end. The portrayal of the Virgin with her son suckling at the breast, known as Galactotrophosa in the Byzantine tradition, was probably far more widespread across the territories of the Eastern Christian Church than its few survivals indicate. At the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem, rebuilt around 1169, several columns are painted with representations of Mary, including the nursing image. I think this I can. To conclude, women's prayers for fertility and safe childbirth have looked for an outlet that promised a hope of success, and it seems more than likely that the consciously evocative iconography of the figurines formed as vessels in the actual shape of their desired function was believed to endow the liquid drunk from them with medicinal and protective qualities. This belief had a long history in the region. A group of burnished terracotta discovered in pharaonic tombs were shaped as woman feeding or carrying an infant with a tall spout and handle attached to the head. Such an analogy might seem far-fetched when made to stretch over almost two millennia, but the memory of this belief could have survived over generations, handed down from one mother to the next, even while the objects themselves, being of a domestic nature, did not survive. I would suggest, therefore, that these vessels were made as containers for liquid, either the milk of a domestic animal or possibly breast milk, which by virtue of the special form of the container were believed to extend therapeutic properties to the contents. It is also possible that the ceramic figurines were a conscious evocation of the Holy Virgin Mary suckling her son Jesus. Mary was revered across all communities as a symbol of motherhood, and as we heard in the account by Abu al-Makarim at Sadnaya, her intercession was sought by women of all religious denominations. Thank you for your attention.
Mark Graves, who was in the unenviable position of having to really talk quickly, so I'll introduce her quickly, is Assistant Professor of Islamic Art and Architecture at Indiana University in Bloomington. She received her PhD from the University of Edinburgh in 2010 for her thesis on miniature architectural forms in medieval Islamic art. She has won numerous awards and fellowships in the British Isles, and her published work has dealt with a wide range of subjects from medieval Islam to 19th century Morocco. Margaret.
Thanks. Do I actually have time to read this talk? How are we? Okay, go. Take my thanks as read here, and I'll just start. This piece is very much a pendant to Melanie's piece. It deals with some of the material from the same group, anyway. The starting off point for this paper is this piece in the Metropolitan Museum, which is one of a much larger group of unusual ceramic objects of this form. I'm going to look across the group as a whole in order to propose some possible ways to fit these pieces actually into our picture, our historical picture of domestic celebrations in the medieval Middle East. So, Art historians have not, to date, been able to come to an agreement as to the meaning or purpose of this group of objects, which are believed to come from Greater Iran. Melanie went into more detail there than I'm going to. They are speculatively dated to the 12th to early 13th centuries, when the area was under the rule of the Seljuks and then their successors. So far as I know, I've traced more than 50 examples of these objects, and I haven't found one that has entered scholarship with a reliable archaeological record in tow. This is a common theme, I think, in this panel. In addition to this lack of archaeological data, nobody has yet identified any kind of reference in the historical sources that would be construed as referring directly to these pieces. This makes them, in terms of academic Islamic art history at least, a bit of a failure, because we do like to have texts with our pieces often. For these reasons, as well as for others relating to the low status of what might be termed folk art within Islamic art history, scholarship on these objects has to date been pretty limited. I've tried to address this situation by proposing an iconographic reading that's actually based on medieval texts concerned with domestic space, drinking, and musical festivities. So today what I'm going to do, and I will try and speed this up a bit, is outline the objects themselves, then discuss the structures that they represent, and then finally come to talk about what the people inside them are actually getting up to and what we can read this as. So the vast majority of examples that I've been able to trace are currently in museums and private collections in Europe and North America, a condition they share with a lot of other material. The majority of the pieces are monochrome glazed in blue or turquoise. The glazes range in color from a light greenish turquoise, rather soapy glaze, to a very dark cobalt blue. The pieces are normally made from a fairly biscuit-colored stone paste body, although some are rather more pinkish. It's evidence of the low to mid-range status of the pieces that they were generally monochrome glazed. And monochrome is obviously the cheapest and simplest option for glazed wares. Although, of course, glazed wares are not in themselves the very bottom rung of ceramic production. That position is occupied by unglazed utilitarian vessels. So I think it's important to remember that although these may look quite crude if you're used to really fine wares, these are not right at the bottom. They're actually probably somewhere in the middle. If we go slightly further up the social scale, there are at least three extant examples that have been painted with luster glaze, which is a considerably more demanding medium. This suggests that both monochrome glaze pieces and versions produced in higher quality materials like luster were possibly available for purchase at different levels of society, so we may be looking at socially stratified production. So obviously the question is, what are they supposed to be? A large number of variations on the form exist, and what I'm going to talk about in this talk today is the most common type, and I think the most unproblematic. The standard plan for the most common examples, which you can see here, is a rectangular four-sided box with a flat top projecting partly over the central space from all four sides, leaving the central well open and generally occupied. On almost every example, bar this luster piece, a perforated edging, you can see it here, stands upright around the inner edge of the top sections, creating a kind of fence around the central area. The four external walls often have some modeling. A few of them have illegible, or at least illegible to me, molded inscriptions, or running animal figures, as we see here. Some examples have upright openings pierced through each end. Now, it's been suggested in some places that these models represent mosques. This, I think, we can very quickly disregard. The form of the models are not really remotely comparable to any known mosques from medieval Iran. Moreover, much more importantly, the figures inside them are playing musical instruments and standing around a table and apparently drinking, all of which would certainly suggest it's not a religious setting that they're in. In fact, these models are, to a large extent, defined by their secularity, as evinced both in the activity of the figures that they contain, which I'll talk more about in a minute, and in the type of architecture upon which they appear to be based, which is what I'll discuss right now. Now, the fact that the objects don't have any obvious comparanda in surviving medieval Iranian architecture is one indicator, I think, that they are made in imitation of a form of architecture that we really wouldn't expect to survive for many hundreds of years. That is unexceptional domestic architecture. So as there are no complete standing examples, and of course the roofs are critically important here, from the medieval period in Iran, one has to rely on an assumed continuity in vernacular architectural forms and compare the models with the old cities of the present day, using Yazd as a case in point. If one looks at images of contemporary domestic architecture from the old quarter of Yazd, one sees that the house models do follow the basic form of traditional urban housing in Iran and surrounding areas. It quickly becomes apparent, I think I'm not going to go into detail about the analysis of different elements, but I think hopefully you can accept this as a comparator here, that this is basically a very simplified but elementally intact version of a very dramatically shrunk, obviously, version of a type of dwelling that's existed in Iran and the wider Middle East for many centuries. That is, of course, the courtyard house. An open courtyard forms the center of the dwelling and leads off on all sides to roofed rooms, either completely enclosed or open on one side to the central courtyard, as you can see here. So now that we have the courtyard house in our sights, the decorative edging, this bit, of the house models becomes a case in point. On many of the courtyard houses in Yazd, the great majority of them, there's a simple upright lip made from a few rows of brick built up to a fairly low height around the edges of the roof that overlooks the courtyard. This has various practical functions. It stops dust from falling into the courtyard from the roof. It provides a small safety block, and it also gives a more neat and level appearance to the roof edge from ground level. So it's an attractive feature as well. Of course, it's important that we recognize the inherent limitations of molded and modeled ceramic as a medium, as well as the tiny scale of the models and their relatively low production standards. All of these things mean that they must necessarily utilize forms that are miniature approximations of the things that they're supposed to represent, rather than being carefully crafted scale models. So I don't think they should be found wanting for not being scale models. That's not what they're intended to be. At any rate, having established that the architectural model being followed by the house models is indeed the courtyard house, I want to look more closely at the significance of this architectural setting to the activity of the figures. Now, you can only really see these. They're very difficult to photograph because you have to look right down into them to actually be able to see what's inside. The most arresting feature of the house models, obviously, is the presence of figures. There are normally 6 to 10 figures of such a size that they stand from floor to roof almost like caryatids, although they're clearly intended to represent human figures engaged in activities, and they are very, very small. We're talking about things that are about this high. So the human figures in this panel have gotten smaller and smaller and smaller. Additional structures representing large jars here and tables with unidentified objects on them are very, very often arranged in the center of the courtyard area. So it's been noted by now many times, and Melanie's paper just touched on this, that this period, particularly in Iran, saw a flowering of figural art across many media. Recent interpretations have questioned some of the earlier theories about the prompts for this. However, I think we can still accept that many of the figural arts from this time, including maybe particularly things like this, were probably produced for a prosperous middle class. The growth of city culture that took place during this period may also have fed into the interest shown in urban domestic architecture as manifested within these. But to come back to the people, the figural types in each house model and the number of figures are not standard. Some houses appear to be populated entirely by figures with cups, i.e. drinkers. Most are made up of a mix of different types of musicians or a mix of musicians and cupbearers. There's also occasionally dancers. Although the quality of the figures may vary, and the group makeup certainly varies from house to house, by and large they do represent a fairly tightly bound iconographic group. That is, cupbearers, musicians, and sometimes dancers. So an iconography of pleasure and celebration. The impression, of a pleasure party is usually compounded by the presence of what appear to be wine jars in the central courtyard of a large number of the house models. So looking at the nuances of this, the iconographic unit of the drinker, which we've heard about earlier in this panel, has been current in the Persian cultural area since long before this period. It's true, as Emilyson says, that the prestige of the cup rites suffered a blow through Islam, but there does seem to be plenty of evidence that wine drinking apparently continued into the early Islamic period and beyond as a festive and celebratory activity, albeit an illicit one. Meanwhile, the image of the drinker, seated cross-legged and holding a cup at chest height with one hand, did remain remarkably consistent through many centuries of Islamic art. So just two examples here, which are extremely, this is extremely well known. This is one of the Victorian Albert's Minayat bowls. Medieval Muslim writers drew very strong links between music and drinking, which I think is reflected in these two-dimensional representations of the drinker with musicians. To find the hidden nuances contained in such representations, what I want to do, because we don't have these useful bolstering historical references to the objects, what I've done is looked in legal texts here. So let us turn to the Revival of Religious Sciences, a compendious text written in the late 11th century, probably in Iran, by the incredibly prolific medieval philosopher, jurist, and theologian Al-Ghazali. Now, two sections of Al-Ghazali's text are of particular interest. The first of these is the book that details the conditions under which music and singing may be lawful. And it should be remembered that this was written in the Seljuk period and thus may be accepted as a reasonable reflection of the actual social concerns of the time. The association between music and drinking really lies at the heart of Al-Ghazali's writing and forms the crux of his arguments against the lawfulness of music in many circumstances. I'm going to give you, on two slides, two long quotes. But these are important. So I quote from Al-Ghazali, he says, "So musical instruments are forbidden as a consequence of wine being forbidden, and for three reasons. The first is that they incite to the drinking of wine. The second is that they, in truth, are closest in kin to the drinking of wine, and they remind assemblies of men of drinking. And the third reason is that the gathering together to do something like that has become one of the customs of dissolute people." So, in fact, Al-Ghazali is characteristically rather inconsistent regarding the lawfulness of music in this text, and he eventually concludes elsewhere, and I quote again, that music and singing is sometimes absolutely forbidden and sometimes permissible and sometimes disliked and sometimes to be loved. But in the section of the Revival of Religious Sciences that deals with the governance of the marketplace, the prohibition is far clearer. The breaking of musical instruments, along with the pouring away of alcohol, is repeatedly referred to as an example of one of the duties of the marketplace inspector. And this is echoed in other HISPA manuals. It's not just Al-Ghazali who cites this as actually a key duty of the marketplace inspector. I think even greater significance to the iconography of the house models is a further stipulation by Al-Ghazali, which is about music when played in a private residence. So the quote here, "Know then that when a man closes the door of his house and is concealed within its walls, no one may enter to discover any sin without his permission. That is, except when someone outside the house can perceive what's going on inside, such as when the sounds of musical instruments are so loud that they pass through the walls of the house. Whoever hears this may enter the house and break the instruments. The marketplace inspector must not eavesdrop by another person's house. He must not try to hear the sound of a musical instrument or smell for alcohol or feel someone's robe for the shape of a concealed musical instrument, nor ask the neighbors to find out what's happening in another house." So, several things are apparent from these legal texts. First and most obvious is that the link between drinking and music was very clear to medieval observers, which would indicate that occasions at which both occurred together were very widespread. Secondly, that drinking was haram and therefore not permitted, but the issue of music, particularly in festive contexts, was far less cut and dried. And most suggestively, the playing of musical instruments in a closed and private environment was an activity that was to be tolerated, provided it couldn't be seen or heard outside the house. Now, this takes us back to the house models. The rise of such laws concerning private space in the medieval Islamic period evolved from the Quranic injunction, do not enter houses other than your own, into a very complex set of laws concerning whether or not it's acceptable to spy on a private house, looking for evidence of a sin when you already know that the sin is being committed. Many medieval authors agree that it's not acceptable to spy in this manner, and in fact, a lot of them are very strict regarding the circumstances in which the marketplace inspector, the government official, the concerned upright citizen, whoever, is allowed to actually enter a private house and prevent sinful acts from occurring. There's actually a lot of anxiety in the legal text about the protection of a private domestic sphere. In light of all these texts about music in the private world, I want to propose that the house models represent a type of festive or celebratory activity that tended, for reasons of propriety or perhaps even legality, to take place in enclosed domestic settings. So they are celebratory objects in that sense. The question, of course, then comes, what type of celebration could this be? Now, some authors have suggested that the disc with seven balls of clay on it, it's not always seven, but it is pretty often, sometimes found in the middle of the courtyard, it's been suggested this represents a pedestal table covered with the haftseen, the seven things beginning with S, of Iranian celebrations for New Year, or Nowruz. This is problematic in that the research I've done suggests the haftseen is actually probably a much more recent convention than it's made out to be. However, the significance of the number seven to earlier Zoroastrian practices still might make a Nowruz connection possible. And the Nowruz argument is very appealing for other reasons, too. Ancient New Year celebrations in Iran appear to have involved ritual wine drinking and music, and these practices apparently continued to the medieval period. Now, in addition to the imagery of musical festivities, coming back to the social function of these objects, it's worth mentioning that Cournal Lebrun noted in his travel writings from Safavid Iran in the early 18th century that there existed a practice of giving the ruler gifts on festival days, and he specifically mentions wax images representing houses, gardens, and other such things that were presented to the king. At the same time, we also have the description of sugar figures at feast in the medieval period, which testify to a parallel practice of creating miniature palaces, trees, and gardens out of thickened sugar and honey for major celebrations. Thus, I would suggest that the house models may well actually be the accidental survival of a much more widespread practice of giving model houses on feast days. But with other examples being made from ephemeral materials like wax and sugar, only the more clunky ceramic versions have survived. There has been one other powerful suggestion about the house models, and that's Ernst Gruber's proposal that they represent wedding gifts. This idea is based in part on the imagery of a different type of object, which is closely related, of which there are two known examples, one's in Berlin here and one is in the Metropolitan Museum. These have flat panels instead of open courtyards on top, and they're decorated with representations of two figures in a bed with a cover falling in folds over their bodies. So the connotations are pretty clear. The imagery of these flat-top pieces, I would suggest, may in fact be descended from very ancient Near Eastern artifacts which show a couple lying on a bed. These pieces are believed to have played some sort of role in ancient fertility rites. And what I wonder is if these pieces, the medieval pieces, represent some kind of lingering cultural tradition that had, by the medieval period, lost its immediate significance, but continued as a decorative motif, and perhaps was connected to wider ideas about fertility. Now, the other piece, which is critical to Gruber's argument about weddings, is this one. I think, just to keep this talk short, I'm not going to actually talk about this piece. This is an interesting parallel to the other objects. You have two figures here facing a figure who appears to be standing on a minbar with drinkers ranged on either side. So, to conclude, there isn't really a clear answer to the question of the meaning and function of the house models. I certainly believe that they represent middle-class domestic environments and were probably intended for middle-class consumers. and that they're best understood as gifts of a celebratory or commemorative nature, that is, in the sense of commemorating a happy event. The concerns shown in the historical sources for the security of a private domestic sphere in the medieval Islamic world, in which certain activities that might not be permissible in public could take place if they were enjoyed privately, are, I think, directly reflected in the house models. These pieces constitute a miniature version of an enclosed domestic space in which a party takes place but is only visible to the viewer looking directly down into them. And this is perhaps a reminder that only God may judge what goes on behind closed doors. Thank you.
I know we've run over. I know everybody's running away. But what I wanted to ask is, come back, Margaret. I think we could have two questions, and then I know they're going to come out and hit me if I don't wrap it up. So please come up on the stage, and if there are any questions for our speakers this morning, this afternoon, excuse me, whatever it is, it's not tomorrow yet. I'd like to ask a question. What would you have said about that piece with the stairs or the minbar?
Well, I know that it's been analyzed, and it's considered to be unproblematic in terms of the material. I find the imagery strange. It's always been read as a minbar. I actually have wondered if it's just a set of steps that he's standing on, which seems much more plausible to me. Why the conflation of a minbar with what is so clearly not a religious setting would ever have taken place, that's puzzled me. The two figures that are facing him, I think we have a bit of a mix-up. I'm not convinced it represents anything to do with marriage necessarily, anyway. But I'll leave it there. Sure.
Anybody? Well, sorry I made you come up here then. Thank you again. I just want to say, finally, thank you to the audience for being here. Thank you to the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation for supporting this event. Thank you enormously to my colleagues, Joseph Lowe and Jennifer Mock and Seguin Strohmeyer in the Education Department, and Julia Rooney in the Islamic Department, who, without whom this wouldn't have worked at all. So thanks so much. Have a lovely evening. And come back tomorrow for Christiane Gruber's lecture in the afternoon.